now we will go to our sixth speaker, Dr. Lamia Al-Ghufeli. Dr. Lamia is a third year medical student at Al-Faisal University. She will talk to us about the prevalence of gestational diabetes mellitus and its fetal and maternal outcome. King Faisal Specialist Hospital experience. Dr. Lamia.
Ma'azaratan, she's not graduated yet, right?
She's third year.
So we'll call her Miss Lamia. Thank you.
Thank you so much, doctor. So I'll introduce to you the our first findings on the prevalence of gestational diabetes mellitus and its fetal and maternal outcomes. This is the King Faisal Specialist Hospital and Research Center in Riyadh experience. And I'll start by defining the gestational diabetes. It is the impaired glucose tolerance and hyperglycemia with onset or first recognition during pregnancy caused by imbalance between insulin resistance and insulin secretion. GDM is characterized by the hyperinsulinemia and insulin resistance resulting in an abnormal carbohydrate intolerance. So in the first trimester and early second trimester, increased insulin sensitivity occurred due to a relatively high, higher level of estrogen. As in the late second and early third trimester, increased insulin resistance and reduced sensitivity due to a number of anatogenic hormones, especially placental lactogen, leptin, progesterone, prolactin, cortisol, and adiponectin. As published by the American Diabetic Association in 2013, gestational diabetes risk factors are being overweight and obese with an age greater than 25 years, a positive family history for diabetes, and having previously delivered a baby who's greater than 19 pounds, and previous diagnosis of gestational diabetes and polycystic ovarian syndrome. Now, why is it important to treat gestational diabetes? According to the Pedersen hypothesis in 1954, maternal hyperglycemia leads to fetal hypoglycemia, which evokes an exaggerated response to insulin, which causes an increased neonatal fat deposition and abdominal girth with increased birth weight. The above was further supported by a recent study published in 2009. For the adverse outcome of gestational diabetes, maternal hyperglycemia will lead to fetal hyperglycemia, thus inducing fetal hyperinsulinemia, and this will bring extra glucose to the baby and causing the baby to put on extra weight and excessive fetal growth and adiposity. This is a picture comparing a macrosomic baby and a normal baby. Now to the outcome of the fetus, shoulder dystocia and birth injury can occur due to macrosomia, and stillbirth, prenatal mortality, and congenital malformation, especially among women with fasting hyperglycemia. And for the neonate, hypoglycemia will occur secondary to the hyperglycemia of the mother, leading to fetal hyperinsulinemia, and hypoclensia and respiratory distress syndrome. During pregnancy, the woman is highly to have abortion and preterm labor, preeclampsia, and microangiopathy and large vessel disease. And during labor, she's at higher chance of having prolonged labor, shoulder dystocia, and periperium to the giving birth, puerperal sepsis, and lactational failure. In the first trimester, the fetus is likely to have congenital abnormalities, and in the second trimester, as we elaborated earlier, macrosomia, and during delivery, birth, asphyxia, and shoulder dystocia, and after delivery, respiratory distress syndrome, and hypoglycemia, and neonatal jaundice. Time of the delivery among gestational diabetic mothers can be affected by the duration of the pregnancy and the control of diabetes and the presence of complications such as pregnancy-induced hypertension and microsomia and past obstetrics history and test of the fetal well-being. And the mode of the delivery can be affected by the parity and push-up source of the cervix and the decay of the pelvis and the estimated fetal weight or macrosomia and associated maternal and fetal complication. Now, coming back to our study, our aim of the study was to identify the prevalence of GDM among Saudi women and to identify the GDM risk factors and to evaluate both maternal and neonatal risk and outcomes. So this is a case control study. After getting the ethical approval in ORA in King Faisal Specialist Hospital, the charts of the patients were retrospectively reviewed. Those patients gave birth at King Faisal Specialist Hospital in 2007. The inclusion criteria was all patients that were diagnosed with GDM, and the exclusion criteria was patients with pre-existing diabetes. In addition, we randomly selected another sample of women with no evidence of glucose intolerance, so no GDM or pre-existing diabetes, as a control sample. The results is shown in both figure 1 and 2. We identified 1,270 deliveries. 2.75 had already diabetes, and 77 patients, which stands for around 6.1, had GDM. Off of these 77 patients, 32% were on insulin and 52% were on diet. And patients with GDM were significantly older than the control group and had higher parity compared to the control group. And there was no difference in the gestational age and the time of at the time of delivery, and no significant difference in the birth weight, as reported in the literature. But APGAR score was significantly better in newborns with a p-value of 0.024, and this was never reported to be associated with GDM. The results is shown in Table 1. Out of the 77 patients with GDM, 16.7 developed complication that led to an emergency C-section, while only one of the 46 cases that were used as control needed emergency C-section. This is with a p-value of 0.001. An elective C-section was also more frequent in the GDM with 13% compared to the control group, but this was not statistically significant. In conclusion, we conclude that there is a high prevalence of gestational diabetes among Saudi women, and that one-third of these patients will need insulin for its management, and that GDM is associated with older age and high parity and low APGAR score, but with comparable birth weight of newborns of normal women. However, a high risk of emergency C-section for fetal complication. So for the future plan, it's our plan to identify the risk of developing diabetes mellitus among those patients who already had GDM, and evaluate the long-term child health status at 10 years old. And thank you so much. I would like to thank Dr. Ali Zahrani from the Department of Medicine and Dr. Awsam Kurdi from the Department of Gynecology, and my colleagues Wajdan Al-Khalidi and Mishael Al-Suwaylam. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Lamia. If anybody have a question from the female side? No, we can go to the male side.
Yeah, I think it was a very courageous presentation by a third-year medical student in a neonatal conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Yes. Ms. Lamia. Please don't take our feedback as a criticism and stop doing your research. It's a nice effort, but you're already trying to prove what has been proven. So I think your main aim is to look at the 10 years outcome. That's why you chose 2007 year.
Yes.
Okay, good. So. Just a little bit of advice. I saw your introduction was very long and you were speaking very fast. Some of the terminology probably you are not used to them yet, because maybe you have not been exposed to the clinical terminology yet. So my advice is that you can review and do rehearsal with one of your seniors before doing the presentation. But don't let this stop you from continuing, please.
Inshallah, thank you so much.
I assume this is your first presentation, so that's really excellent for a first presentation.
Thank you so much.
So next year you will do better than me.